welcome everybody today. Today is already the third week of our series, Tech Balance, Technology, Social Media, and Your Relationships. Today's April 30th, so speaking of social media, it took about 5 seconds for me to see the first Justin Timberlake, It's Gonna Be May meme. Today, it's gonna be May. I've had that song in my head all morning, thanks to whoever did that. And then we've got, Star Wars Day coming up. May the 4th be with you on May 4th. And so those are good uses, I think, of technology. But what we're saying in this series is that we probably all have a love-hate relationship with smartphones, with technology. I appreciate technology. I use it every single day. We have essentially started our church with Facebook and Instagram and YouTube, and we are so thankful for the online service, as I just mentioned. And at the same time, we know that there are pitfalls to technology and social media. To be honest, I've gotten more positive comments about this series than I have in a long time. And I think it's just because we all need it. We know we do. I need it as much as anybody else. And we know that we probably, if we're really honest, spend too much time online. And sometimes it can affect even our face-to-face relationships. We know for sure that technology can have both a positive and negative effect on society. We can keep in touch with loved ones at a distance. That's an amazing use of technology. Online church. We've also seen how propaganda and false news spreads on social media and the destructive power of that. And then as we talked about last week, the comparison trap. How we can, you know, get on social media and just assume that other people have perfect lives, because all we can see, if you were here last week, that little square where everything looks perfect inside the Instagram square, but then everything outside of that is cluttered and normal, just like our lives. And so we know at the extreme, technology can affect our relationships, make us feel more anxious and stressed out about life, make us feel, you know, worse about ourselves, and then we're not as emotionally available to the people in our lives that we want to be available to. And so during this series, we're talking about living wisely, how to live wisely with technology and the internet and social media. Today, we're talking about technology, social media, and how you feel about life. Now, technology does not just affect us in the specific moments that we're using them. Instead, what tech and just internet access and social media have done is they have created the atmosphere that we all live in every day. They're highly influential, and they've revolutionized our society even more profoundly than TV did in the 50s. And so they just kind of set the tone for our society, how we interact with each other, what we think is important, what we focus on, what we think is really happening in our society, and how we feel about life in general, whether it is the comparison trap or whether it is troubling things that we see shared through social media or online, etc. So when we're asked if we believe that life is getting worse or better, how we feel about our future, how things are going for us as Americans, many of us, I don't know if you'd call it a negative response, but we're kind of like, we're concerned. We're concerned about our future. We're concerned about the way life is going right now. There are lots of things that need improvement, always. And at the same time, there have been numerous studies finding a correlation between a high degree of social media use and certain kinds of social media and the way we feel about life. Anxiety, depression, increased suicide rates. Yes, among the young, but also those of us of all ages. The world just doesn't seem to be going well if we pay attention only to the internet and video news and social media. And it can quickly be the case that the most extreme, loudest voices are the ones who set the tone for how we view our future, how we feel about life, and it just adds to our stress, our anxiety, our worry about the future, and just how we feel on a day-to-day basis. So we're talking about how to live wisely, how to live well today, and how to feel better about life. All right, so this is the map that most of us grew up seeing in our classrooms. This is the map that Google uses for Google Maps. Anybody know what this is called? Any just straight-up nerds like me? Because I love this stuff. Anybody know what this is called? The Mercator Projection. That's what it's called. Close. Somebody's like, a map. Yes, you're right. You got it. This is called the Mercator Projection. And this is a cylindrical projection of course, the Earth. And it was created in 1569 to be used in navigation. And what cylindrical means is, of course, the Earth is round. Can we agree on that in 2023? I know in some parts of society, as we're talking about today, that may cause a problem. But the world is round, and when you unfold a globe, you can't make it flat. It just doesn't work like that. And so if you're going to make a map flat and then turn it into a grid that can be used for navigation, you have to distort the map a little bit to make it flat. And so when it comes to seeing the world as it really is, the Mercator Projection is helpful for navigation, but it's not helpful because it distorts the size of the continents or the countries closer to the poles. And so it gives a skewed view of the size of these countries. So if you look at Greenland up there, which is covered in ice, Greenland is an absolute unit, correct? I mean, this thing is huge. Look at the size of Greenland. It's the size of Africa. I mean, amazing. And then look at Antarctica. Antarctica's a boss down there, just taking up the entire, bottom fourth of the map. And you see the size of Russia up there and Canada. Wow. These countries to the south, or continents to the south and to the north, are just absolutely huge in the Mercator Projection. Now, it is, it's been suggested that the use of the Mercator Projection in navigation and in navies and armadas actually helped to promote colonialism, because it gives a distorted view of countries that ended up colonizing other countries. It made the colonizing countries look a lot larger than they really are. And there's been this thought, well, is there kind of a superiority feeling that comes from this distorted, skewed view of the world in the Mercator Projection? Here's the real size of these land masses. Isn't that interesting? Now, if you see that on a globe, then yeah, you would. If you're used to looking at a globe, then you would know all that is the size. Greenland, ah, boy, sorry, Greenland. Not going well for, look at Antarctica down there. This is the real size. Isn't that interesting? I'm the only nerd in this church, apparently. I love this stuff. The Mercator Projection, even though it's useful for navigation, it may be how you got here today, using Google Maps. It gives us a distorted, skewed view of the world. We're not able to see the world as it really is because it gives us a distorted, skewed view. A couple of weeks ago, my wife Hannah and I took our two boys to a driving range. And we take them, and they hit golf balls for an hour, and we sit in a chair. It's one of our favorite forms of exercise. And we just, good job, buddy, good hit. And we just talk. And at this particular driving range, you have to go up to this kind of the shack where they sell golf balls and they sell drinks and snacks. And there's usually a little line there. And while standing in line, there's a few of us there waiting in front of the window. And the guy in front of me stepped up to the window with his buddy. And he ordered a bucket of golf balls. And he turned to his buddy, you want to get some drinks? Yeah, let's get some drinks. And then he looked into the kind of the beer cooler in there, and he said, well, I'm not getting a Bud Light. I know that much. And okay, because I had paid attention to the news. It was really fresh last couple days. I know what's going on. He really wanted everybody to hear him. He said it two more times. Well, I'm not getting a Bud Light. I know that much. It really was like, okay, pal, like we all get it, we all get it. And then he took really probably a full minute saying that over and over, and then deciding what beer he wanted instead of the Bud Light. He's making a scene. I'm not exaggerating the situation. He was making a scene out of it. He's kind of rude to the guy at the window. And if you don't know, a few weeks ago, Bud Light made a social media advertisement giving Bud Lights to somebody who is a celebrity who is trans. And I believe it had a picture of that person on the can. And I think it was like an Instagram ad. And there was an immediate backlash from some folks in society. Kid Rock set up Bud Light cans and mowed them down with what seemed like an automatic weapon. And that kicked off video after video on social media, people shooting and exploding Bud Light cans and boycotting Bud Light. Bud Light sales did take a dive. And at the same time, what was lost, I think, is about half of those major beer companies support pride festivals and gay rights causes. They didn't used to, but after some pressure, they decided to. Coors Light became one of the first and leading sponsors. So they sponsor the Denver Pride Festival and other gay rights causes. And so this guy at the driving range, he took a full minute to decide what beer he wanted instead of Bud Light. And then he eventually said, just give me a Coors Light. So all of that. And I was angry at the guy. I think everybody was annoyed. We're all waiting. Nobody cares about your political views while we're all waiting to get some golf balls. And so I was angry at him. To be honest, I was disgusted. And at the same time, I pitied him. Because we're at a driving range. And the only thing that you should be angry about at a driving range, if you're like me, is fixing your slice. That's the only thing that should be bothering you. It's a leisure activity. It's supposed to be peaceful. We're outdoors. We've taken our families here. Everybody's trying to have a good time. And I thought, is this where we are? That in 2023, we go to a driving range, and we have to hear an angry, agitated guy loudly proclaim his political views as he buys golf balls and a beer. Is that where we are? The answer is yes. That's where we are. And I pitied him, because as I just looked at him and I thought, I wonder if he ever asked himself the question, how does a Bud Light beer can actually affect my life? I don't think he asked that question. I think he consumes a certain form of media, probably listens to certain talk radio people, watches certain channels or YouTube videos from those news outlets. The social media algorithms feed him content that just makes him more and more rageaholic. So he's angry at the driving range in line, making a fool of himself because he's so worked up about who is on a beer can. And I support trans rights. I think it's great that they did that. And then Bud Light equivocated. They put the person who created the marketing campaign on leave. So they're not heroes in this situation. And I thought, you know, the way that technology can be used and false news outlets and social media propaganda, they can skew our view of the world like the Mercator projection. They can distort our view of the world so we don't have an accurate view of the world. We don't have an accurate view of life. We don't have an accurate view of what really matters. We don't have an accurate view of what actually affects our lives personally. And so on week one of the series, I read a quote by a professor in the American Psychological Association's article, Media Overload is Hurting Our Mental Health. And his name is Matthew Price. He's a professor at the University of Vermont in Burlington. He tracked adult participants for 30 days, and he asked them to assess how they were getting their pandemic-related news. This is back in 2020. And he found that there was an association between more exposure to news on social media and higher rates of depression and PTSD that they didn't find if somebody just watched TV to get their news or read a newspaper to get their news. And so I showed this quote on week one, but I want to show it again. But an emotional correlation wasn't identified among adults who relied more on traditional media sources, such as newspapers and television for news, Price said. He said that the heightened effect with social media sites might be embedded in the way they use news to reel us in and retain their users. They're designed to be limitless scrolling, he said. When there's a big news-related topic of conversation that's negative, it can dominate what you're seeing. It can give the impression that this is the only thing that is happening. And so in week one, we talked about how if you're just paying attention to social media, like so many of us are, multiple times a day, you get the idea that this is what's really happening in life. Certainly, that's what this man did at the driving range. To where something that has no effect on his life is such a big deal, he has to be angry about it at the driving range. But that affects us in ways, you know, you could be completely supportive of trans rights like I am, but we consume news through social media or just the comments we see, and it affects the way we feel, and we get the sense that life is more like what we're seeing on social media than what it really is. And it distorts our way of our view of reality, like the Mercator projection. And so when we think about how we feel about life, how we go throughout our day feeling about life, are you bothered by all of the nonsense and the doom and gloom? And do you feel bad about yourself because of the comparison trap? And is that how we're created to feel about life? If you just read through social media feeds, does that describe who God has created us to be? And how we're meant to feel about life, what life is all about? And so I don't think it is. I think there are some skills we need to learn as guinea pigs, as we said on week one. We're the first humans in history that are having to deal with this onslaught of false news and propaganda and just negativity through social media. And God has something better for us. And so I want to share a scripture. This is from Psalm 37. And I think this scripture is a guide for how we're meant to feel about life. If you find yourself feeling negative, if you find yourself bothered, anxious, stressed, if you're falling into that comparison trap, I think Psalm 37 is really one of the ultimate guides for how we're meant to feel about life. And it's an interesting thing. By the way, just to kind of give us an idea of the Bible and interpreting the Bible, in Hebrew, because this was originally written in Hebrew, this is an acrostic poem, so that each line of the poem begins with the next letter of the 22-letter Hebrew alphabet. That's how much time was put into the art that we're about to read. Psalms is the hymn book, the song book of ancient Israel. And so we're reading a piece of art here. It doesn't come across in English, of course. But this is a response to the problem of evil. Why do bad things happen? Why does the world seem so messed up sometimes? And of course, we've all asked that question. And how should we feel about life when we see bad things happen? So let's read it together. Psalm 37, and I'll read verses 1 through 9. The psalm writer says, "Do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when people succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes. Refrain from anger and turn from wrath. Do not fret. It leads only to evil. For those who are evil will be destroyed, but those who hope in the Lord will inherit the land." Doesn't that sound like a pretty good way to feel about life? And so if we look at the action words and the phrases in this passage, here's what we see. Just the action words, do this or don't do this. Let's take a look. Do not fret. And I love this Hebrew word here that we translate as fret. It means to burn. Like, don't get heated. Don't get hot under the collar. I love that. It's just a great picture. Don't get all worked up and on edge and heated about what you see happening. Do not be envious. Of course, social media can tempt us to be envious. So don't get heated up. Don't get worked up, hot under the collar. Don't be envious. Instead, you can trust in the Lord. You're not alone. You can partner with God. It says, do good. Do good things in the world. Take delight in the Lord. Think of the word delight. It means pleasure, enjoyment, joy. Feel joy. Take joy in your relationship with God. Commit your way to the Lord, your path. Allow your life to be guided by the Lord. And this is, God will do this. It's kind of a promise. God will do this. If you commit your way, if you do these things and you commit your way to the Lord, God will do this. God will make your righteous reward shine. And the word for righteous there in Hebrew is tzedakah. Tzedakah. Do you want to say it with me? Say it. Tzedakah. Tzedakah. And it actually means justice and righteousness. And Hebrew thought those two words are fused together. Tzedakah, justice and righteousness. And it doesn't just mean, oh, I'm a good person. I'm a personally moral, pious person. Justice and righteousness has to do with society. It has to do with the kind of country we live in, the kind of land we live in, where everybody is treated justly and rightly. We do right by everybody. We care about everybody. Everybody has a fair chance where there is justice and righteousness. So if we don't fret and we don't be envious and we trust in the Lord and we do good and we take delight, we find joy and enjoyment in doing good and in our relationship with God, and we commit our way to the Lord, God will make our justice and righteousness shine as a people. That's a pretty good way to feel about life. And then says, be still. Be still. Take a breath. Feel peace. Experience tranquility. Wait patiently for the Lord. You don't have to scramble. You don't have to be in the rat race. You don't have to be in the hamster wheel. It's not just, let's all look busy. Let's all run around. And maybe that will make us feel better if we doom scroll. Maybe that'll make us feel better. Wait patiently for the Lord. Refrain from anger. Now, there is such a thing as righteous anger. You can get angry for a good reason. But then there is a kind of anger where we fall into this rage, just like the guy in line at the driving range. We become rageaholics, victims of the outrage media, just consuming outrage. They just make us mad, and then we listen the next day just so we can get mad again. Refrain from anger. And then finally, hope in the Lord. Hope in the Lord. Now, that seems like a pretty good way to feel about life. And as I think about that passage and those action words and phrases, and how, you know, tech and social media really can create the atmosphere that we live in, where we don't feel good about life, I think there's a way that we can apply this passage specifically to our use of tech and social media. And so if you're a note taker, you could follow along. But one of the things that this passage says to me is, don't fret. You know, refuse to get heated up. Refuse to get hot under the collar about these things by reminding yourself that social media, false news channels, and other sources of internet outrage skew our view of the world, just like the Mercator projection. Just start there. In other words, we're skewed. You like what I did there? They skew our view of the world. Just start there. When I get online and I read my Facebook feed, when I see what's going on Twitter, when I watch any news outlet on YouTube, there's a very real possibility that these things are skewing my view of the world. And so there's a good question to ask whenever, I guess multiple times a day for most of us, when we're exposed to social media, tech, video, how does this news, quote unquote, or this post, or this opinion, or this video really affect my life? That's a good question to ask nowadays. Does this really affect my life? For real, in the real world, where we all actually live, does what I'm seeing online really affect my life? Is this worth my time and my energy? Is this real, or is this social media nonsense? Is this something that I can get engaged in, or is this something I really don't have the ability to do anything about? Those are good questions for us to ask. Romans 12:2 says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Don't conform to the pattern of this world. Everything that we read does not necessarily reflect reality. It gives us a skewed view of the world. For example, if we were to talk about whether the world is actually getting worse or better, and we were accurate about that, we would be called naive. You will never hear a politician say what I'm about to say, because they would be called out of touch, and they would never get reelected, and they would just be used in attack ads, you know, incessantly. Statistically, life on planet Earth is better now than it's ever been in the history of humanity. That's a really uncool thing to say, isn't it? Let's be honest. You're like, what? Is Ryan out of touch? Poverty's down. Poverty's way down. Famine's down. War, believe it or not, down. We have a climate crisis. We have things we need to address. Is the world perfect? Of course not. Is life better than it's ever been for human beings? Of course it is. When's the last time you heard that on social media? You're all very quiet right now. Birth rates. The infant mortality rate is a single-digit fraction of what it was 100 years ago. There is an increase in focus on human rights around the world. Better medicine. Human beings have never had it so good on this planet. Closer to home. Yes, the United States really is being shaken to our core right now. Democracy is being challenged. We have a shrinking middle class with wage stagnation, inflation, housing prices, especially a place like this, are completely out of control. We have mass shootings. We have many, many problems. Once the climate, many, many problems. But we do have a skewed perspective on the issues that face us as a country and how polarized our country is. Now, you might think I'm crazy, but I'm going to prove it to you. If I were to ask you right now, is crime up or down in the United States over the past 20 years, what would your answer be? Crime is way down. You know, I might get booed off the stage, I feel like, any second now. I'm not sure how you're responding. Violent crime right now is two-thirds what it was in 1990. In 2014, violent crime was half of what it was in 1990. We won't ask for a show of hands, but how often do you hear that? No politician's going to say that. There was an uptick in 2020, no surprise there. Life was rough in 2020, but still far, far lower than the early 90s. And Americans are actually far less polarized than we think. For example, last year, I'm going to quote findings from Pew Research, the Gallup poll, and Politico. See if you're surprised by this. Last year, let's go to the next slide here and take a look. This is the percentage of Americans who were asked about each of these issues, and they said, yes, this is a very big problem or a moderately big problem. So the percentage of Americans who basically said, we need to deal with this. Very big problem or moderately big problem. 93% inflation. 93% of us agree. Not a whole lot of division there. Do you agree with me? 87% of Americans said affordable health care is either a very big problem or a moderately big problem. We need to address it. 77% of Americans said infrastructure like roads and bridges are a very big problem or a moderately big problem. Anybody surprised by this? 76% of Americans said gun violence is a very big problem or a moderately big problem. 69% for climate change, 69% for racism. More specifically to the gun violence issue, 59% of Americans, according to Politico, last year, this is last year, before the most recent shootings, 59% of Americans want stricter gun laws, and now 71% of Americans support same-sex marriage. Do you see a lot of division on the screen? Anybody surprised? When we opened the well back in 2018, right before the pandemic started, I gave a series called United States of America, Y-O-U. See what it did there? United States of America. And I started the series by pointing out that America is actually a lot less divided than we think. When's the last time you heard that? I knew coming up here I'd kind of feel like a crazy man giving this sermon, because this flies completely in the face of what you see 100 times a day on social media, in every news video, in every politician's speech. It flies directly in the face of what we hear. Now, of course, a majority is 51%, anything over half, that's a majority. A supermajority is usually considered to be about 66%, two-thirds, up to 75%. So in actuality, we're supposed to be a majority rules country. A supermajority of Americans agree that these issues are either big problems or moderately big problems that need to be addressed. A super majority of Americans are saying these things. Well, what's the obvious question? Well, then why don't these laws get passed? Well, there are some easy answers, actually. Gerrymandering, propaganda, false news outlets, social media spreading false and negative news a lot faster than positive news, entertainment and opinion being presented instead of news on quote-unquote news channels. I mean, I just ran off the list right there. This isn't a mystery why America is basically, is it a democracy at this point? I don't know. When you think about what Americans actually think about the issues and whether the will of the people actually gets done. See, this thing and our consumption of all of the stuff on this thing skews our view of the world. It distorts our view. We think that Americans are more divided than we actually are. I fully invite you to do some Googling of your own. We swim, we live in this constant barrage of negativity, talking about how polarized we are, how outrageous all these things are, how we can never get anything done, and what's happening to America, and where are we headed, and what does the future hold? FDR famously said, "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself." You ever heard the quote, "The best way to think you have, the best way to give away your power is to think you don't have any"? Anybody ever heard that quote? When we think that the world we see on social media is actually the world, that's the problem. When we can step away and see, no, like the Mercator projection, it's giving me a skewed, distorted view of the world. And we can unplug ourselves from the matrix. And I think as a people, we'd be a lot better off. Second, as another example, the governor, Arnold Schwarzenegger, gave a moving speech this week and some interviews at an event he called Terminating Hate. And which reminded me, when I was getting ready for the sermon, I still don't know how to spell Schwarzenegger. He's been a star since the 80s. If somebody said, "Ryan, either spell Schwarzenegger correctly or we're going to kill you, just kiss me goodbye. It's over. I have no chance of spelling Schwarzenegger." Schwarzenegger is a Republican. He's a former governor of California. And he gave a speech this week against hate, against anti-Semitism, against racism, saying we know where these things lead and we need to prevent bigotry from taking the United States down a predictable path. Now, I knew he was from Austria. I didn't know some things about him. I think this is common knowledge, but I didn't know it at least. So, of course, Hitler was part Austrian. And in World War II, Austria was a vehemently anti-Semitic place. And I guess this has been public knowledge, but I didn't know this. Schwarzenegger's dad was a Nazi. Did you know that? And he flatly said that in the speech. And I was, wow, I'd never heard him say that before. But I guess it's been known for a while. But he was born in 1947, right after the war ended. And he called anti-Semitism and bigotry and racism the path of the weak. He called it the path of people who are weak and broken, and said his dad was one of those guys. And he said this in an interview. He said, my father was, and so many other millions of men were, sucked into a hate system through lies and deceit. And so we've seen where that leads. I'll spare you the horrible Schwarzenegger impression. I'll just read this normally. I've seen firsthand how broken this man's, he's talking to his dad, or these men were, the kinds of atrocities that happened, how many millions of people had to die, and then they ended up losers. In the Confederacy, losers, as they all have. This just doesn't work. I mean, let's just go and get along, and love is more powerful than hate. The governator, right? And then he went on to say that as long as any political party digs this hole deeper and deeper, going down this path of hatred and bigotry, they're going to continue to lose. You can Google how Hitler died. You can Google how Mussolini died. It did not end well for them. It did not end well for the Nazi Party. It did not end well for the Confederacy. We know how this script plays out. And when it comes to the election, according to Schwarzenegger, he said, when it comes to the election, there are too many people now who in America who have seen what this is and what has happened over the past few years, and they're going to see the difference. And they don't want to go down this path. Now, you might not feel as optimistic as he does, but the point that Schwarzenegger is saying is, and I think if we want to apply this passage, is we can take delight in the Lord. Enjoyment, pleasure, find joy. By reminding ourselves of the actual low percentage of loud extremists in America. We can find joy and remind ourselves, no, I can be more joyful about my life when I think about the point that Schwarzenegger is making. That there are a lot more of us than there are of them. A supermajority of Americans agrees on the major issues facing us. But I've said this before. Those who know the least often know it the loudest. And we have a small percentage of extremists in this country who are very loud. My son, my 12-year-old, pointed out he saw a guy standing on the side of the road with a flag with a certain political candidate's name on it in 2024. And you might see that and think, wow, look how dedicated all these people are. Or maybe you think of the crazy uncle you've had in the past who would do something like that. There are more people who are not that extreme than there are the extremists. We can take delight in the Lord because we're not fooled by the volume. We're not fooled by the decibel level. Louder does not mean it's more popular or that there are more people who think like that. It's just loud. It's just volume. So a supermajority of Americans agree on most of the issues facing us. It's just that we don't regularly hear that through tech and social media, so we don't know how powerful the majority really is. The reason for that is that most of us just want to get some golf balls and hit them at the driving range. Most of us are not standing on the side of the street holding a political candidate's flag. Most of us are not putting blisters on our thumbs, tweeting out crazed conspiracy theories. People who are more extreme are just louder. And it is a concern. But there are a lot more people who aren't like that. And there are people who are like that. But there has been radicalization in our country. False news outlets and social media have amplified extremist voices. There are algorithms that feed what you're already into, so you see more of it. So it seems like there are more of them than there really are. I listened to a video this past week. I can't play it because the guy was cursing all the way through the video, which you might be tempted to do too when you think about these things. But he basically said, he was talking to somebody from England, and this is an American guy, and he's explaining our situation. He said, over the past few years, our blankety blank, 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 you know, politicians, he said, here's what's happened. Everybody has the crazy uncle that before the internet would say all kinds of crazy things. Now, all the crazy uncles just feel like they have permission to say them out loud, and they have the internet. He said, that's basically what's happened in America. And I loved it. It was great. I wish I could play it in church, but maybe this church I could, but I'm not going to risk it. But sociologists Andrew Whitehead and Samuel Perry, who are known for writing the book Taking America Back for God, which is the study on Christian nationalism in America, they found that about 30% of Americans would be classified as Christian nationalists. Now, you think, it is alarming. Now, you think, man, that's a high percentage. 30%, that's a high percentage. That is concerning. Now, here's something you're not going to read on Twitter much or see on Facebook. Or you know what percentage is higher than 30%? 70%. Isn't that great? Anybody want to say amen to that? You know what percentage is higher than 30%? 70%. In fact, it's more than double the percentage of people who are saying all these terrible things. 70% is a super majority. A super majority of Americans are not Christian nationalists. 70% of us are more sensible. There are a lot more people who aren't than people who are. It's just that those who know the least often know it the loudest. And we can take delight in the Lord by reminding ourselves, no, don't be fooled by the volume of the extremists. We were setting up today for the service, and there are these big curtains in the back, the different colors of curtains here in the stage, and there's some outlets, and we were trying to get to them, and we were joking about pulling back the curtain. And somebody mentioned the Wizard of Oz. So how the Wizard of Oz, of course, the classic example, it's all this smoke and mirrors and this awe-inspiring thing, and wow, what's going on here? And it's really just a guy behind the curtain turning some lever, you know, some wheels and pulling some levers, and we can pull back the curtain. Say, wait a second here. We can take delight in the Lord. I can find joy in life. I want to be on God's side. I want to be on team God. I want to be on team good. And there are more people who want to be on that team, whether they're religious or not. There are more decent people, people who at least have some commitment to the golden rule, to do unto others as you want them to do unto you, than there are people who are just ranting in line at the driving range. I can take delight in the Lord. And so again, perhaps our greatest challenge is separating our real local social experience from what the artificial one created through tech and false news and social media propaganda could lead us to believe. Skews our view of the world. Next to last, we can be still. When we encounter any kind of extremist, any kind of extreme loud voice, we can be still by asking yourself if this person is really interested in discussion and therefore worth my energy and time, and should I really be annoyed or should I just move on? I'm very much an advocate of silence benefits the oppressor. So, and I'm going to make it this last point next. We never want to be silent in the face of injustice or wrong. That's just letting it slide. We never want to be silent. When it comes to individual people in your life, there are times when silence is an answer. When you just don't need to dignify their comment with a response. When you don't have to take the debate. There was a lady in our church during the pandemic who said she had an epiphany. And I think it might have been a Thanksgiving dinner with one of those uncles that the podcaster was talking about. And he was just going on and on and on and on. And they've had discussions before. Her whole family knows how she feels. She's not silent. She's made herself abundantly clear. And she said in this one particular dinner, I just decided, you know what? I don't have to take the bait. If people are not interested in a discussion, I don't have to pretend like they want to have a discussion. You don't owe people a discussion who are not into, they're not interested in a discussion. And so when you encounter extremism online, maybe it's your Facebook friends, maybe it's your family, you can pick and choose your battles. They need to know how you feel. You don't want to be like the secret person who was against racism. No. But every single time, do you need to say something? Sometimes silence is an answer. Sometimes walking away. Sometimes ignoring people is a way to just get the message across. Proverbs 23:9 says, "Do not speak to fools, for they will scorn your prudent words." Some of you, that's your new life verse. What's your favorite verse in the Bible? Proverbs 23:9. There's wisdom there. It is wisdom literature. And you can ask yourself, you know, I don't want to just write somebody off. I don't want to call somebody a fool if they're really not. But there's only one question that's going to answer it for you. Are they open to new information? Or are they just looking to rant what they saw on social media or their favorite fake news channel? Are they open to new information or not? If they're not open to new information, the Bible does call them fools. And Jesus said it like this, Matthew 7:6, "Do not give to dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to what? Swine, pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and turn and tear you to pieces." It means don't throw something of value to somebody who doesn't appreciate it. Don't throw your expensive jewelry to pigs on a farm. If you're at Thanksgiving dinner and your crazy uncle is saying something and you just decide that you're going to enlighten him, well, he'll probably just end up calling you names. Some of you have experienced that, unfortunately. And it just depends. Not everybody's like that. We don't want to write people off. But if they're not open to new information, you can be still when you encounter an extremist online or in person by asking yourself, is this person really interested in discussion? Is this worth me getting worked up about, fretting about? Or is this person really not interested in new information? And then finally, I think we have the opportunity as we read Psalm 37 and think about tech and social media and the way we feel about life. Commit your way to the Lord, because how you feel about life, and this is important, is meant to be joy while working for justice. What is your default mode supposed to be? How are you supposed to feel about life? Are you supposed to be like, oh, like, you know, you're just like the warrior, you're always stressed out and your cortisone levels are elevated and you're anxious and just worked up and, well, no, do not fret. Don't be hot under the collar. We don't want that. But the way we're meant to feel is to take delight, to have enjoyment, to be able to enjoy life. Some Christians feel guilty saying that. It doesn't mean being a hedonist or a materialist, but the default mode for all of us, the way that God has created us to feel overall about life, is joyful. And that's okay. While partnering with God to work for justice, commit your way to the Lord, and what will he do? God will promote justice and righteousness in your land. Make it shine like the noonday sun. So we don't. It's not ignorance is bliss, and I just ignore everything bad in the world because life's good for me, and in a place of privilege, I'm just happy all the time. It's not what we're talking about. We're talking about having joy, enjoying life, while partnering with God to work for justice. Now, many of us who were raised in church were raised to have a really overly somber view of Jesus. Jesus is just like this. He's buckled down. Jesus is strictly business. And furrowed brow, and he's crusading and arguing and preaching, and that's kind of the view that we have of Jesus. And we read the Gospels kind of like they're a legal document or a thesis paper. And we just get really dead serious and furrowed brows about what we read. And we miss what really, you know, if you weren't raised in church and you just read these words, it might be easier for you to see this. Jesus said things that are funny. It's easy to miss this. Jesus used humor in his teaching. I mean, for example, as a teaching in Matthew, when Jesus is saying, don't judge people. Don't look down on other people as though you're better than them. Don't look at the speck of dust in their eye. And then maybe there was a piece of wood laying around. And when Jesus, and he picks it up, and he says, don't try to get the speck out of your brother's eye when you have a plank sticking out of your own eye. Maybe you had a piece of driftwood. And people are going to chuckle. He's having fun with that. It's a funny picture. You know, don't talk about, oh, you've got a speck of dust in your eye when you've got a 2x4 hanging out of your own eye. He says, first remove the plank out of your own eye, and then you'll be able to see clearly to help your brother. You know, that's funny. That's a lighthearted guy using an illustration. That's funny. Two of Jesus' followers were named James and John. They were known as the sons of Zebedee. That was their father's name. And in Luke 9, Jesus was preaching in Samaria. And the people didn't respond the way that the disciples hoped. And so James and John were like, well, Jesus, should we call down fire from heaven and burn all these people up? Like, that's a realistic possibility. And Jesus is like, no, we shouldn't do that. We shouldn't call down fire from heaven and burn all these people up. And it says he rebuked them. They were hotheads. James and John, they were quick to fret. They were kind of outraged. And in Mark 3, we're given a list of Jesus' disciples, and it lists James and John. And then it said to them, Jesus gave them the name Sons of Thunder. So James and John, Jesus nicknamed them the Sons of Thunder. Sons of Thunder, it sounds like a tag team in WWE, does it not? So he sees these guys who are hotheads, his followers, and he's teasing, he's ribbing them. It's lighthearted, friendly teasing to say, simmer down, guys. Calm down. Not everything. We don't have to call down fire from heaven all the time. You know, oh, here come the Sons of Thunder. Everybody cover, you know, watch yourselves. Duck, everybody. Here come the Sons of Thunder. That's the guy who's having fun with the people around him. He nicknamed Simon. Simon Peter, in Greek is Petros, basically named him Rocky. Your name is Rocky. Doubting Thomas, he apparently had a twin, a brother or a sister, and he called him the twin. He just nicknamed his disciples. There are some people who, they're not sure what Iscariot means, as in Judas Iscariot. There might be some connection to red. And there were some scholars kind of surmising Jesus may have called him red, like he had red hair. And that could have been a nickname, which apparently Judas didn't appreciate. But Jesus had fun with his disciples. This is a guy who's having fun in nicknaming them. So while Jesus was on his mission and Jesus was working for justice, Jesus had joy along the way. That's meant to be the default mode that we feel in life. How are we meant to feel about life? The default mode, the baseline level, is joy. To be able to take delight in the Lord. To be able to be still, to be patient, to know that things are rough. We have a lot of challenges. But there are so many good things that we're ignoring because we have a skewed, distorted view of the world. And perhaps that's our greatest problem, is to get a realistic view of the world. So I'm going to close with this. This past week, the late night talk show host James Corden had his last show. And you may know his dad, his name Malcolm Corden. He's been on the show many times. His dad used to like work in Bible sales. Like he used to be like a Christian book salesman. He'd sell Christian books and music in England. And his dad and his mom have been on the show many times. And a few years ago, there was a certain politician who was photographed holding a Bible awkwardly. And maybe part of the way you feel about life is you're so disturbed, like I am, but seeing things like this and the way religion is used. And when that happened, James Corden invited his father, Malcolm, to do a funny segment on the show. And so Malcolm made a skit about how to hold the Bible. And then he read a passage of Scripture that was eerily relevant and comforting during that time. When I saw it, I had tears that welled up in my eyes when Malcolm read this Scripture. And so it's a couple minutes long. I muted a couple of parts where there's a name said because I just don't want to hear it. I don't think we need to play names. But let's watch here. Malcolm Corden, How to Hold a Bible.
Now, you've held your fair share of Bibles in your time, and you've actually put together a little tutorial of ways for the president or anyone else to hold a Bible without embarrassing themselves. Let's have a look at Dad's tutorial.
Hi, I'm Mal, and here are some ways to hold the Bible. So this is the underarm, and it's handy to give away. If you don't want it, hand back under the arm, away you go. And this is the pizza box. James, you know all about pizzas. but this comes with a side of salvation. And this one, close to my heart, I call it the Margaret, my loving wife. And hopefully I'll get some brownie points, I can play golf tomorrow. And then there's this one, the testimony, like when you're in a courtroom, I'm sure he knows all about that and he could be using it again very soon. And then there's this way, the open Bible, which I'm sure he's never done, because open Bible, open heart.
Oh, that's great, Dad. That's very helpful. Thank you very, very much.
Good, good. Well, I thought as I've got the Bible open, I would, and considering the fact that it appears that doesn't read the Bible, I thought I'd give a passage from Psalm 37, which is one of my favorite Psalms. So this is, it's 8 verses from Psalm 37. Is that okay?
I don't know how long 8 verses is, Dad. Is that a lot?
We'll try it. I mean, yeah. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. He will make your righteousness shine like the dawn, the justice of your cause like the noonday sun. Be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret when evil men succeed in their ways, when they carry out their wicked schemes.
Thank you so much for sharing that tonight, Dad. We'll try not to fret. We love you so much. I miss you. And we'll talk to you very soon.
All right, mate. God bless. Love you loads.
Love you, buddy.
When I first saw that, I saw that on YouTube. I mean, I'm thankful. Saw that on YouTube. And when he read that last verse, do not fret when evil men succeed in their wicked schemes. I just had tears in my eyes. Oh, how powerful. Now we are engaged, we're informed. People, we want to partner with God to work for justice. As Malcolm said, and God will cause our justice and righteousness to shine like the dawn or like the new day sun. When it comes to how we feel about life, some of this information is challenging because we just don't hear it very much. But our default mode is meant to be joy. And joy while partnering with God for justice. The internet, false information on the internet, false news outlets, propaganda shared on social media, they distort, they skew our view of the world like their Mercator projection. Our world is actually better than what we see on these devices. And perhaps it's asking ourselves, no, what's real? And when you have a supermajority of Americans agreeing on what's the most important thing, and we're not fooled by the loudest, most extreme voices, it's a lot easier to not fret, not get sucked into the outrage machine, but work for justice and delight ourselves in the Lord, to feel joy while being engaged, committing ourselves to the Lord as we partner with God to bring justice and righteousness, and you can feel good about life as God causes justice and righteousness to shine like the noonday sun. I invite you to pray with me. Oh God, we thank you for this beautiful passage and for a funny, cool skit that expresses joy and beauty. And oh God, you know that we are bombarded, as Dr. Price found in this study we quoted, by this limitless scrolling of news. Now, there are things we enjoy about social media. I'm thankful for it in so many ways, but there's so much negativity. There is so much false news that it skews our view of the world, distorts our view of reality like the Mercator projection. And perhaps that is the greatest tool that's being used by some to hold us back, to keep us from realizing what these reputable polling organizations are telling us. A supermajority of Americans agree on most of the issues that we face. We're not as divided as we're made to believe we are. Quickest way to give away your power is to not think you have any. Oh God, we want to commit our way to the Lord. We want to delight ourselves in you. We want to not get sucked into the outrage machine. We want to partner with you, experiencing joy, but in your work to bring justice and righteousness. And we want to see reality as it is. And we don't have to get pulled into this fake sense of reality dominated by extremists. Basically fall into their hands and do what they want us to do. Just to not realize, no, actually most of us do want solutions. And we can feel joy as we make life better for all of us. Oh God, help us as a people, yes, as a church, yes, as individuals, but as a country to realize this. This is a message that needs to be shared. And God, we thank you that you will make righteousness and justice shine like the noonday sun. And we can feel joy. We can feel that shining in our own lives on Monday, just like Sunday. We thank you for what you're doing here and what you will do in our hearts and in us as a people. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.